NASA's always had their eyes and ears in space to see if they can't sniff out some alien life, or at least signs of it. Over the years, it has identified more than 5,000 habitable exoplanets, but there was no way of knowing what the environmental conditions of these planets were. Even Hubble wasn't able to accurately discern atmospheric and geological conditions of these planets. But the JWST unlocked the secrets that its predecessors couldn't. A few days ago, NASA researchers came across an exoplanet which had significant quantities of carbon dioxide in its atmosphere. Carbon dioxide is one of the most fundamental gases for the proliferation of life. So what does the discovery of this life-sustaining gas entail? Could it suggest the presence of organisms that rely on photosynthesis? Or is it the result of another phenomenon completely? Let's dive in to see what we know. The discovery came when the JWST was observing gas giants and exoplanets in distant solar systems. Now the Webb has been observing these parts for a long time, and a few months prior found the first unequivocal sign of water vapor in the region. This was when it was able to zone in on a WASP-96b, which is an exoplanet some 1,150 light years from Earth. This puffy gas giant has a temperature of 1,000 degrees Fahrenheit, but showed distinct signatures of water vapors in its clouds and haze. Though the temperature and size makes this planet inhospitable, the mere fact that the JWST could identify and analyze atmospheres light years away was impressive, and many knew that some major breakthroughs were on their way. While still observing the constellation Virgo, the JWST focused its observations on a puffy gas giant named WASP-39b, which is some 700 light years from Earth. The planet is much bigger than Jupiter and has been identified before by both the Hubble and the Spitzer space telescopes. The Spitzer, like the James Webb, used infrared spectroscopy to analyze how light interacts with planets' atmospheres and has been able to identify signatures of water vapors, potassium, and sodium coming from the gas giant. But it was the James Webb that caught the scent of carbon dioxide lurking deep inside the planet. Eliza Kempton, an associate professor of astronomy at the University of Maryland, commented on the discovery saying, "The reason we haven't been able to definitively identify CO2 in the atmosphere of WASP-39b previously was that we never had a telescope that could produce spectra across the right wavelength range." This discovery shows us that Webb is delivering on its promise of being a transformational facility for astronomical observations. The discovery was made using Webb's NIRSpec. This is a very sensitive instrument that splits incoming light into a spectra to analyze which parts of it were emitted, absorbed, or reflected. It uses infrared spectrograph to break down incoming light and arranges them like barcodes to see which wavelengths are missing. Those missing wavelengths are the ones absorbed by the planet. These planets don't emit their own light, but rather reflect light coming off of other stars. During a transit, some of the starlight is eclipsed by the planet completely, which causes a dimming of the starlight. But some light is transmitted through the planet's atmosphere, as shown in the image. The valley represents the blockage of light. The way the planet interacts with its residential starlight says a lot about its atmosphere composition. How does the interplay between light and gas help us see the constituent parts of a planet's atmosphere? Well, in the words of Kempton, a research matter expert, Kepler and TESS observe transits in white light, whereas JWST can observe a transit in hundreds of colors all at once. JWST can do this because it's equipped with spectrographs that spread white light into infrared rainbows of color. You see, unlike the Hubble Space Telescope, which detects light in the visible spectrum, the JWST can see past dust and clouds in space to get to the light coming from the distant stars and galaxies. This gives it a lot of material to work with. All matter interacts with light to some degree by absorbing certain wavelengths and reflecting others. Think of chlorophyll, for example. The green pigmentation of plants comes from chlorophyll's ability to absorb reds and blues in the visible spectrum and reflect the greens, which is what we end up seeing. Now, the same thing is happening with planets. The atmospheres of planets have a disproportionate distribution of gases, and since all gases interact differently with light, we know the chemical makeup of the atmosphere by seeing what wavelengths don't make it to us. For instance, if we look at this small spectrum of infrared radiation, we see that almost all wavelengths go unabsorbed except for the ones at 4.4 microns. The spike indicates that almost all that wavelength was absorbed, and the only compound to do so is carbon dioxide. This is fascinating because this is the first time that carbon dioxide has been found on an exoplanet. And the team over at NASA was very enthusiastic about the findings because they believed it would open a new door in the study of worlds outside of our solar system. Team member Laura Kriedberg of the Max Planck Institute for Astronomy in Heidelberg added, "These first results are just the beginning. The early release science data has shown that Webb performs beautifully, and smaller and cooler exoplanets, more like our own Earth, are within its reach. One reason this is an important discovery is because Earth, for instance, had its landscape dominated by volcanoes that left carbon dioxide in their wake. But with the evolution of a family of algae, the amount of oxygen in the air became a major constituent. So the presence of carbon dioxide might be a precursor to the formation of life on the surface of WASP-39b. It could also be home to a species of microorganism that relies on anaerobic respiration. WASP-39b orbits extremely close to its parent star, WASP-39, at less than 1/20th the distance between Earth and the Sun, completing one orbit about every 4 Earth days. It resides in the Goldilocks region of that solar system, which means that it isn't too close to get burnt by its sun and not too far that it freezes over. Despite its ideal location in the solar system, scientists hypothesize that if WASP-39b had an atmosphere like ours, it would long ago have succumbed to solar flares and intense radiation. It is not suitable for life, at least not the kind of life we imagine. Multiple plausible evolutionary paths could have generated different environments that can potentially be home to life forms we cannot conceive. Carbon dioxide on Earth is usually the result of the carbon cycle, but also because of the emissions due to human activity. Scientists feel that finding CO2 in the atmosphere of another world is an important step towards finding chemical biotracers of extraterrestrial life. Carbon dioxide is a chemical species that has been found in nebulae and supernovae, but its existence on habitable exoplanets could be an indicator of metal enrichment. These metal enrichment processes have a large influence on the evolution of both the exoplanets and their environment. This could mean that in some billion years, time will weave through the environment of WASP-39b and hopefully turn into something remotely resembling Earth. But this is a bit of a gamble, as the initial conditions, like the formation of the solar system and the galaxy, influence the result. Well, at this point, everything is just speculation, but it's a big unknown universe out there, and anything is possible. Detecting carbon dioxide in the atmosphere of small, terrestrially sized planets definitely opens up new avenues for the discovery of other exoplanets with the same characteristics that we haven't been able to detect before. Also, seeing that the JWST is producing such incredible data so early in its mission means that we are definitely on the verge of a breakthrough sooner rather than later. This data is only likely to improve as time goes on, and with it, we can get a glimpse into how the universe became what it is and quite possibly dabble in the origin of life itself. But so far, the question of extraterrestrial life is a Russell's teapot. We cannot prove it, but we also have enough evidence that denying it outright would be difficult. But for now, all we can do is watch the stars and hope that our efforts inch us closer to the truth. So there you are, guys. I hope this video offers some good insight. If you enjoyed it, be sure to hit the like button and subscribe to Tech Luminous for more content like this. And as always, thanks for watching.